In Romans 8, here's something that I would get and you wouldn't get. Okay? So let's see how you do this. It's not a sermon. This is what I might do in a little chapel service, but I couldn't do this really. I don't know. I could probably do this this week. In Romans 8, there's a passage. A lot of people know it. And it says, what then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who's against us? He who did not withhold his own son but gave him up for us all, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to be there? It's a familiar line, isn't it? So I'm reading one day and some obtuse scholarly thing, and they said, yeah, these are the Greek versions of Latin terms, Latin court terms, legal terms. So I'm going to give you the image that you see in the text. You heard it, you saw it just like I did, but you might not have caught it. There's a judge, and in this passage, that judge is God. God will judge us. And there is somebody who could be accused. Let's call that the defendant. Does that work? And because you know, I know, I'm going to use Pete because he's guilty of so much. Yep. So, Paul actually is making a court scene picture of God sitting at the front of the room, Pete sitting over at the defendant's table, accuser. At the prosecutor's table, which currently is empty, but will be filled soon by the prosecutor, we hope, are the files on Pete. Not this bed.
That's it?
Yeah. It's really bad. Pete, you are toast. And the picture is, in walks Jesus. And it's like any court scene. In America, I can't go prosecute somebody. You actually have to have the prosecutor do it, the people's prosecutor. You can't, I can't volunteer, I have to be a designated. Jesus is the designated prosecutor. And he walks in the courtroom. Here's the prosecutor's table. Jesus facing the judge. Over and sits at the defendant's table. It's not to say Pete isn't guilty, but there will be no case. Who is there then to accuse? Now, there are volunteer accusers. There are a couple people in Pete's life who'd like to say, ooh, let me tell you. But Paul is using rhetorical questions. In other words, but they can't do it. They're not the accuser. And I know a few things about Pete without even knowing him too well. I tell you, folks, sometimes Pete volunteers. Listen to me, you really should convict. But there's only one who can make the case, and he has chosen not even to go to the table. So there's not even a start. Case dismissed, Pete. Go home with your right out of the Bible. I think that's pretty powerful. Paul creates that image, and I'm waiting for Jesus to come fill in the prosecutor's table. He won't do it. The only one who could accuse doesn't. Now, is that a gripping image? I didn't have to go anywhere for that right there. I did happen to learn it from a scholar, but he said it in the most uninspiring way ever. I'm amazed I even got it. sermons can be enhanced by lots of things that we didn't talk about today. They can be enhanced by music. They can also be, could I say, disenhanced? I had this fun experience that some of you have sung the song Me Here. I wrote it about 10 years ago. It's a good song, I think. It means a lot to me. It's sung in a lot of churches. So I go to this church one time, and this woman is a rebel. She's playing the piano. And she does this weird little thing on the piano, and then the next thing you know, people start singing words that I have written. That was not what I wrote. It was pretty bad. She's the piano player. I never want to have her touch any of my songs ever again. And somebody bumps me and says, "Hey, Rod, we're singing your song." And I wanted to say, "No, I've never heard that ever in my life. I don't know what you're talking about." Okay, you know church music can be downer or an upper. I understand that. But music, we didn't talk about today. Often in a 9 o'clock and 5:30 services, the sermon really isn't over until the song is sung after. Integrated into it. The song Sunday about facing our troubles, facing our wounds, facing our failures, facing our golden calf moments, finished with a song, "You'll be alright, come morning light. Very moving." And it said, "Even when you face your fears, even when you face your failures, come morning light, you'll be okay." So that fit the sermon really, really well. I have an advantage at 9:11. I can tap into a contemporary in the middle of that. 9:30, sorry. At 11, I can't do that. So they just do a typical offertory on the organ. But I do find it's kind of cooler to have the other. We didn't talk today about logistics. We didn't talk about lighting. Sound systems. We didn't talk about articulation or projection. We didn't talk about your speech speed. You notice I speak very fast, but I have developed a few devices to make me not at least as fast when it's Sunday morning. We didn't do a lot of that. What we did talk about was topic and point. And that the point ought to be rooted in the text. But the early 20th century was built around people talking about how the early church took its message. And they used the word kerygma. Do this with me, would you? Okay, put your hands up here. And just clap. Okay. Kerygma is that point. That's the thing. Right? It's not... Or it's not. It's, and you know, in art, in design, people talk about something popping, or in advertising, something needs to pop. And I guess when I talk about that point, I want to ask that topic sentence, that faux text, can you make it pop? So, a couple of thoughts illustrated with enthusiasm, or illustrated with artfulness, or illustrated with story, but find a way where when you're done, hopefully you feel like that. This fundamentalist guy one time says, "You know what being born again is? It's heaven kiss the earth, you right in the middle of the smack." You know, I hope that instead of thinking of that as a once-in-a-lifetime experience, that's kind of what you're working on every Sunday, to bring people to the place where they're in the middle of the smack. You know, I took my little boy when he was young, and we'd hug him, mom and dad both. "Come here, Adam." We'd put him between us, and there were moments when his face just went bliss. Life's going to be really hard on him. This moment, he's like, And wouldn't you know, my son's beautiful life.